From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Welcome to the Old Men's Hour. I had planned originally to start asking Lord some of the big questions, but I thought we'd start some. I've been reading a lot of his fiction over the last several weeks, in many cases rereading it, having a very good time, and picked up a few little motifs that keep popping up in his fiction, and I want to start out by asking him about these. Ward was in Washington for a good part of the 60s. Many of you may know that he was the Washington Post correspondent who was really our first important reporter in Vietnam as that war was beginning to shape up. And in fact, the shaping up of that war is the subject of his recent and very good novel called A Dangerous Friend. Ward Washington's changed a lot. When you published The American Ambassador, you wrote lawyers, journalists, politicians, diplomats, Washington characters. The ambassador had spent his entire life in the milieu of government. But about three decades later, in Exiles in the Garden, you wrote, the grand dames were gone. The elder statesmen were gone. The small town of his youth was now a metropolis spilling over into the Virginia and Maryland countryside. When you looked at the downtown with its barriers and snipers on the roof of the White House, you could believe you were living in a garrison state. Alec noticed that his street was crowded with German automobiles, the large versions.
I'll be damned.
You don't get back here much, do you?
I don't. I don't know why. I live on an island. I live on Martha's Vineyard. And with each passing year, it's tougher and tougher to catch the boat and then catch a car and then catch a train and 12 hours later find yourself in Washington, D.C. But every time I come back, I'm energized by the place. This whole area right around here, I've never seen it before. Right. It's been years, I mean, 5 or 6 years since I've been here. All of the new infrastructure, as it were, and
right.
and Walter Pincus pointed out to me, there's a condo kind of business on the street, 7 floors, 7 apartments. That they don't call apartments, they call them houses. Mm-hmm. And since they're 2,500 square feet, I suppose you can call them houses.
Right.
There was nothing like that
right.
in Washington in the old days, I don't think.
A great man of our era never made it to Washington. He figures as a cameo in 2 of your novels, Echo House and An Unfinished Season. I'm talking, of course, about Adlai Stevenson.
Yeah.
I understand you had at least a brief acquaintance with him.
I did. We didn't see very much of each other. I was working for Newsweek then and working in Chicago. And I was 24 years old, trying to learn the trade. But the connection that I had with Adlai was that my father and grandfather owned a newspaper in Waukegan, Illinois. And they spent regularly, when elections would come up, they'd spend their time denouncing Adlai as a communist thug, sort of KGB character. You have no idea the lengths to which my father and grandfather would go. So when I happened to come across him at a party somewhere, and I can't remember where that, where it was, we shook hands and he looked at me and he said, are you one of those justices? And I said, yeah. I said, I'm supposed to be the inheritor. And he looked at me and he knew that I was ripe for convert. And as a consequence of that, when the 1960 election rolled around, everybody wanted Adlai to run. Everybody, essentially meaning Eleanor Roosevelt, I think. He gave me an interview that was to be run in Newsweek, and that was a coup. Unfortunately, the time was such that the magazine had already gone to press, and I never got to publish the interview. But since then, I talked to him from time to time until he died, alas, in 63 or 4, I think. He was just a wonderful man. I've got to repeat his great moe. He was denounced from the pulpit of the marble cathedral church by Norman Vincent Peale. And people asked Adlai what his response was. And he said, well, he said, I've always found St. Paul appealing and Dr. Peale appalling. Is that the best political moe you've ever heard in your life?
Well, during that same 1960 election, Stevenson came to North Carolina to support the gubernatorial campaign of Terry Sanford and Jack Kennedy, of course, and came to something in Raleigh. I was the editor of the student newspaper, and a small group of us were in a room with Stevenson, whom I had never met. I introduced myself, and I said, Governor, my parents are friends of your old Princeton roommate, Francis Comstock. He said, oh, Franny Comstock, how's he? Huh, we were roommates. I tell you, though, he voted for Ike twice. during that period when you were in Chicago, that must have been the same time when you were a habitue of the 1111 Club.
I was.
There was a guy there named George Brunus.
That's right.
I've discovered in reading your work that you and I love the same music.
Yeah.
And so there are people who pop in there like Cole Porter and George Brunus and Jack Teagarden and Ella Fitzgerald. And the blues is a subject that obviously interests you a lot. You write in An Unfinished Season, the blues were part of every life, even a privileged life. Behind the finger-snapping facade of the blues was a glum house of betrayal, thwarted ambition, sexual totalitarianism, lies, and misprision. But then elsewhere you say, if I can find it, in the American blues, it was music drenched in sadness and fatalism and the dignity that comes with a certain knowledge that the past is prologue. And in Rodin's Debutante, my father told me once that all you need to know in life you could learn from American blues, mostly forbearance, but other things too, like tolerance and compassion.
Gosh. Well, a funny thing happened to me on the way to the typewriter. Maybe this would be 8 or 9 years ago. I switched entirely to classical music. And the thing about that it's had an effect on my work that I really can't describe adequately. But of all the composers, Gustav Mahler seemed to loom largest. And in fact, I wrote pretty much an entire book listening only to Mahler's Sixth. It is a very somber book. Is all I can say about it.
Which book is that?
I can't. I'm damned if I can remember.
Exiles in the Garden?
Yeah, it might be Exiles in the Garden, as a matter of fact. I think it's a book called Exiles in the Garden. That's book 3 or 4 books ago.
Speaking about influences on your writing, I know that early in your career, you were strongly under the influence of Hemingway. Now that you're a grown-up, have you gotten over that?
Love to go back and reread.
Do you really?
Read the short stories. It's that dialogue that just can't be. It can't. It can be imitated, but it can't be matched. Such as the line that I think is the greatest in American literature. Just to set the scene. In the middle of, it's a hellhole of a town in the middle of Spain, man and a woman, man's back and forth to the little cafe nearby, bringing a new beer each time, and they're having an argument, and the argument is over, should the woman have an abortion or not, because she's pregnant? And he says, says to her, "Don't worry. It's they only let the air in a little." And two lines later, she has cause to say to him, "Will you please, 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 please stop talking?" Mm-hmm. That line is just magical to me. And the story, it's beautiful. It's, you know, it's, I don't know, it's Hemingway at his absolute best. I mean, there's some awful junk, but not a lot of it.
I have to say, I pretty much stopped with A Farewell to Arms.
Yeah.
But I noticed it when, in talking about Scott Fitzgerald, you say, "A gallant gentleman who was roughly treated by critics and contemporaries, that bastard Hemingway." a Movable Feast is a mean book.
Oh, it's a terribly mean book. He was not a nice man. No one would wish himself to sort of replicate his life. It was after the Second World War. It was one downhill. Despite The Old Man and the Sea, I mean, I sort of like it. I don't know if it's Nobel Prize quality, but they gave him a Nobel for it, and his other works. But there really wasn't much after that, except parts of A Movable Feast, which have really a sweetness about them. And then there'd be some knife slash would go across poor Fitzgerald and Ford Madox Ford and Gertrude Stein and the whole troupe of them.
The other day, I had read, for the first time since I was very young, I had read The Last Hurrah and found parts of it immensely amusing. Thought that I would read another great American political novel and return for the first time in many years to All the King's Men. The first paragraph was Dime Store Hemingway. I couldn't read another note. And that influence was just so pervasive for so long. But I think people our age are the last. I think our generation is pretty much the last one that was under that.
I agree. Except I was talking to somebody in the publishing industry not too long ago, who said that Hemingway's books continue to sell and sell and
well,
sell.
Well, I think they sell. I think for one thing, they're widely used in schools.
Yes. Yeah.
Now.
What a role model.
Right. Yeah. Yes, boys and girls, be like Papa. How about Henry James?
I really am crazy about Henry James, who stands at the opposite pole, from Hemingway.
Are you crazy about James all the way to the end, the late James?
Yeah, except the New York edition that's got each book has got another 100 goddamn pages. Because James wanted to refine everything down to the head of a needle, I think. But oh my goodness, what he could do with conversation.
Yeah.
With literate conversation. Literary. It's literary conversations between people that are. It's stunning. Well, he's awfully easy to parody, by the way.
Yes, it is. I don't quite understand. I didn't come to James until I was into my 70s. And I picked up The Portrait of a Lady and was just stunned. And then I sort of began and got up to one point in early and late James, and I found myself, swimming punching air.
Yeah. Did you read Gora's book? Michael Gora was an academic who wrote
That's the book about the writing of Portrait.
Exactly.
It's a wonderful book, yeah.
It's the best book if you have any interest in James or high American culture, I guess. This book is the best explication of a novel I have ever read.
I thought so. I couldn't agree more.
It's just a splendid piece of work.
Now, in the view of many people, James's heir in American literature and a writer that you and I both admire is Peter Taylor.
Yes.
I was lucky enough to know Peter and moderately well, because he was much older than I, but he was like Adlai Stevenson, he was a gentleman.
Yes. Yet I never met him, and I always wanted to. He wrote a kind of a limpid prose about events that seemed to go back and forth between Memphis and Nashville,
right.
And there was part of a family that lived in Nashville, part of it lived in Memphis. And their trials and troubles and what one family didn't like about another family, and there was always some kind of ghost in the past that's hovering over. Just, he is a James, don't you? I absolutely think so.
Okay, let's, some of the things that people would want me to ask. I know you've been asked this before, and I've sort of apologized for bringing it up, but it's a question of endless interest to a lot of people, me included, for one thing, because I can't write fiction. In an unfinished season, you say, it is a mistake to infer the author's life from the author's fiction. And then in The Weather in Berlin, you say, Truffaut's great task in his movie, The 400 Blows, was not to make the boy into himself, but to make himself into the boy, not autobiography, but anti-autobiography. And all the incidents taken from life and acknowledged to have been taken from life, but that only meant a faithful recollection of the emotion involved, not the fact, but the emotion from the fact. And while personality was not an innocent bystander, it was not fundamental to understanding either. God help anyone who tried to deconstruct the magician's art. Okay, you come from a family that owned a medium-sized newspaper in Illinois, and you wrote a novel about a family that owned a newspaper in Illinois. You covered the war in Vietnam, and you've written several books and stories, fiction and nonfiction, set in Southeast Asia. You have been in Washington, and you've written a number of, I think, exceptionally fine books about a certain class of people in this city. You spent some time in Berlin, and you wrote a very good novel, The Weather in Berlin. And I think and the Midwest is a huge presence in your work. So how does this come about?
I just try to be specific about my own situation. Somehow leaping out of journalism. I didn't understand some of these things until much later. You really have to disappear. Let me just say, I should do another preface. Everybody's got a different answer to that to that question. I'm not trying to lay out great laws of laws of fiction writing. It's the way things turned out with me. You have to figure out a way to disappear yourself, to become a kind of a ghost at the party, I think, and a ghost who seems to have some kind of almost supernatural way, a sense of all the others, a sense of who the others are, even down to something like the names. This is all a little bit abstract, but the writing of fiction is kind of an abstract proposition. What else should I say about that?
You said to somebody that you had always wanted to write fiction.
Yeah.
What happened that made the transition from a very good newspaper reporter and one who also did time in the editorial department, how did that transition happen?
It happened because of the presidential election of 1968, where I covered Nixon for 6 long months. From the winter up to the Republican National Convention, where I was relieved and went over to the editorial page. For 6 months, I had been writing in the pieces that I would write, almost always contained one pregnant phrase, the plan to end the war and win the peace in South Vietnam. Mm-hmm. I thought if I had to write that goddamn clause one more time, I would drive myself crazy. And I recognized in some strange way that I was finished with journalism. I really went into journalism at a au fond because I didn't know what I knew that nobody else knew. And I think that's the key to the writing of fiction. You know something that nobody else knows. And it's something you shouldn't talk about, but you feel secure inside your own head. So after a while, after the war in Cyprus, the war in Vietnam, the political campaign, there were other political campaigns, by the way, I didn't see where I could advance myself in that. I didn't want to be an editor. I had no interest in running the newspaper or anything like that. That would be a catastrophe. And I didn't know which direction to go, except writing fiction, which is something I've been thinking about for, my goodness, you know, how old was I? If I was 30 years old, I'd been thinking about it for 25, I think. Just the ability to tell the truth, which you can so rarely do in journalism, not because the reporter's a liar, but because the reporter doesn't know all the facts. It's the old adage, the first version of a story is always a little bit wrong. Mm-hmm. And you can't get beyond that. That's impossible to happen in fiction. It you can't write a wrong sentence because you're writing a sentence out of the imagination. Right. It may be a little bit maladroit here. It may be, you know, difficult here and there, but it can't be wrong.
Anne Tyler told me once that when she is between novels, that characters will start getting into her head and start knocking and saying, bring me to life. does that sound familiar
to you?
Yeah,
it sure does. It sure does. The other thing, and just to sort of add to that, the one thing that you can do that has amazing results sometimes, if you're having trouble with a character, change the sex. If it's a man, make him into a woman. I'm not talking about sort of gender blending or that. You change the name, and all of the name is Joan and Jan. It's amazing what you can do with a character to change the gender. It gives you a whole new outlook on what he's up to, and all of a sudden it's a she.
Stringer is your first novel, right? Stringer is the first?
No, the first novel was a novel called The Soldier of the Revolution. Stringer came next.
So the both of those novels came out of Vietnam.
They came out of Vietnam, yeah.
Did you and Dave Halberstam cross paths?
No, we were of different, there were three generations in Vietnam. There was a generation centered around 1963 and 4, and then the others 65, 66, and 67, and then the reporters who got there around Tet Offensive.
Right.
And so we never crossed. We later became great friends, mm-hmm. but we never crossed paths out there.
A friend of mine, too. You say Vietnam is the chief subject not only of Soldier of the Revolution, but of Stringer, the American Blues, Dangerous Friend, American Romantic, as well as numerous short stories and two early works of nonfiction. You've written a lot about it, but there was one passage from American Romantic, his most recent novel, that really jumped out at me. The war fit no known pattern or precedent in American history, with the possible exception of the Revolutionary War. It was sui generis and unspeakably tedious, unless you were engaged with it day by day. When you were there, the war was your entire life. As seductive as the sun now disappearing over the western hills, their outlines becoming indistinct. You get that feeling in A Dangerous Friend. You were there that's all there was.
Yes. It's interesting, the question about being there and not being there, being able to, you know, never been in Tokyo in your life and write a chapter about it. I think you could probably do that with ease. You couldn't have written that paragraph without actually being in Vietnam.
Right.
Maybe that's a little bit of what I mean when I was talking about you know something that nobody else knows. Mm-hmm. That paragraph could have gone into four or five books. Now that I think about it,
you don't beat people over the head with it, but you have an immense interest in the power.
I do.
The people who wield it, the people who are affected by it. Echo House, for example, is a novel about power, among other things.
Yeah.
A lot of that seems to grow out of your Washington experience.
It does, but it also grows out of a thought that American writers aren't interested in power as it is actually. It becomes a cartoon, or it's approached from the standpoint of Marx or whatever. They all seem to be powerful. Actually, I like to write about people who are just below summit, as opposed to a senator. I prefer to write about a representative.
Jack Ants,
yeah. So it just struck me that some of their dilemmas are often never spoken of in exactly the same way. So much fiction doesn't ever take into account people going to work.
Right.
How are you earning this money to hang out in Martha's Vineyard? And so you say, well, okay, this guy's a hedge fund manager, and there's a baseball player, or something like that. But whole novels you can go by, and you don't learn how people earn their keep.
Well, yeah, I years and years ago, I don't remember the context, but I wrote a piece about that and said that work is the missing element in American fiction, with the exception of Theodore Dreiser, and some of that hack novelists. People don't go to work.
That's absolutely true.
I think the last. People do go to work in your books, but the last interesting American novelist that I can think of in which work was an important factor was John Marquand.
Yes. Yeah.
Almost totally forgotten.
That's true.
It's a great loss.
I'm reading Balzac's great novel, Lost Illusions, now. And page after page, frankly, more pages than you really need, about the printing industry. About how the banking system works, three or four other things, and no American novelist, me included, knows half of what, say, Balzac knew, and he built a whole novel around it.
Well, of course, and that's particularly true now. People who've read me in this room know that I have a bugaboo, if not a mania, about the influence of the universities and the writing schools on American fiction, and the problem with that is those the people who are brought into fiction by that route have never worked. They don't know anything about the work experience.
That's right.
They know about going to school.
That's right. That's right.
And I think that is one reason why literary fiction is becoming more and more divorced from the general American culture.
Exactly. Yeah, I think so too.
So. You folks want to ask some questions? We could do that. Somebody's very eager.
Yes. First of all, I've always wanted to tell you this. I loved your short story, The Congressman Who Loved Flaubert.
Oh, thank you.
And I've
thank
always you. Thought of Bill Cohn, who writes poetry. I wonder if he ever read that and what he thought. Senator Bill Cohn, Secretary of Defense Bill Cohn. Okay, my question is, you still read the newspapers, and you still probably are interested in foreign correspondents and what they write and say. Yeah. I wonder how you think foreign correspondence as an art, as a craft, has changed on the quality of writing of foreign correspondence today?
I think the serial nightmare that's going on in Central Europe and beyond has raised a whole new crowd of foreign correspondents, many of them women. When I was in Vietnam, there were three serious women correspondents. Maybe they have some different, maybe this sounds sexist, I don't know, I don't care. I think they see things in a little bit different way than say Halberstam or me. It doesn't mean that it's better, what it means is that they have insights that Halberstam and I, you know, wouldn't have. You know, I thought for a while that the business of foreign correspondence was really sort of going down the drain. Far from it. Some really wonderful work, extremely dangerous work, much more dangerous than Vietnam ever was. And so they deserve a hand, and I think they'll, as long as some of the big papers hang on, they'll hang on. I mean, you fear for them because their employers, you know, awash most of them in a lot of red ink, so.
I might just interject from a personal note. My son Jim, for about a dozen years, has been a foreign correspondent for the New York Times, first in Beijing, then in New Delhi, and now in Rome. And he's covered, among other things, the factory collapses in Bangladesh, and most recently, the migrant crisis in Sicily. And I don't know, it looks to me as though there's still some people who are doing a mighty good job. It's covering the Middle East right now.
Yeah.
Oh boy, terrible.
Yeah, yeah.
Anybody else want to ask anything?
We've solved all the problems of the world.
I guess we've solved the world's problems. Well, I did note, and I shouldn't let this pass, an unfinished season, which I have to say really is my favorite among your books.
Ah, thank you.
And it may be because I have something, because I may have a weak spot for coming-of-age novels,
yeah.
Of which it's a masterly example. But it's narrator, one of the few first-person, or is he the only first-person narrator in your fiction?
I think so.
Yeah, is a man, and now in his 60s, looking back on the summer of his, when he was 19, and spending, he was, his family owned, no, I'm confusing that with family trust. He got a job through a friend of his father's at one of the Chicago papers, probably the Chicago Daily News.
Yeah, I think that's what I had in mind.
Yeah, and he was, you know, he was doing all the scut work that a 19-year-old kid would do. He says at one point, why would anyone want to be a newspaper reporter? It's so sordid what you have to see and do. And then, he says, I went to a newspaper office downtown as if I were attending classes at a progressive trade school. I had no intention of becoming a newspaper reporter then or later. The work was repetitive and easily grasped and didn't lead anywhere I wanted to go, which I suspect very much echoes your own sentiments. But, a few pages later, I loved my job and the atmosphere of the newsroom, never quite real, as if the people we wrote about were characters in a play or novel who did not exist outside the narrow columns of type. Its atmosphere was as special and specific as the locker room or infantry bivouac, with its own language and code of conduct, as disheveled as life itself, a man's cruel world where the odds were eternally 6-5 against.
Yeah.
You had a pretty good time as a newspaper man.
Yeah, I really had a great time. It's impossible in those days not to have a great time because...
You started out on a small paper in Illinois, right?
Yeah, it's my father's paper.
It was your father's paper.
Yeah.
But you were born in Indiana.
No, I was, but that was my mother was there visiting her mother. And I was born, and then we immediately went back to Chicago. I mean, there some Hoosier people called up and asked me if I'd accept an award of some kind for, you know, being a Hoosier. And I said, I can't do that. I said, I've thought of myself as from Illinois and Chicago my whole life. I can't change persona that fast. It'd be a fraud. So they went away.
And of the Midwest, you say... The Midwest was, this is an unfinished season, the Midwest so fertile, so enormous, the horizon line stretched to the limits of the known world, but there was no space to breathe.
I'll be damned.
And same novel, Chicago had a 19th century identity, a noisy, unlovely city of iron and concrete, a city on the grab, fundamentally lawless, its days spent chasing money and its nights spending it. Loveliness was always just beyond the point. The city had elbow room, but God help you if you fell behind because there was always a more muscular elbow. The city was run by a half dozen old white men to suit themselves.
That's pretty true, I think.
Yeah, well, you know, the two cities, that have had two American cities out of which the best, most durable fiction has risen are Chicago and Los Angeles.
Yeah.
Very different places. Yeah. Very different. The difference between Nelson Algren and Raymond Chandler is quite broad.
Yeah,
Saul Bellow and Nathaniel West.
Yeah, that's true.
But Chicago sits there in your memory.
It does. You really never get those early experiences.
And you can't really shake the Midwest, can you?
No. And you wouldn't want to. There's something unforgiving. Midwestern people, as a rule, are very nice people. They pride themselves, Minnesota nice and all that. But often, just below that, a scalpel awaits. Kind of, God help you. But you try to. There's a sort of a Midwestern balance that I like. New York's in imbalance somehow.
Right.
So is LA.
Right.
But Chicago, despite the fact that it's going broke faster than any city in America, I think, it's a great place to be from somehow. Mm-hmm. I've been back there in many years, but it remains.
Washington, which for I'm sure at the time you were here, people thought of as a place that people came to from elsewhere, has turned into a fairly decent place to live, and you don't have to be part of that crowd.
That's right.
In order to live well here, it surprised and pleased me in the 18 years I've lived here. Thank you all for coming. I think I should let you know that Ward does. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Sorry, I got here late. I wanted to ask Mr. Chest what he thinks of the quality of the writing coming out of America's recent wars, both fiction and nonfiction. And particularly, I'm interested if he thinks that maybe some of the nonfiction writing in particular seems to be presenting kind of an idealized version of the American military, that often seems to be at odds with what we actually see in the newspaper stories. That is, we get books that seem to, play up the heroic qualities of a lot of American servicemen and women. But then when you look at the newspaper, you look on television, you read about instances of rape, of wartime atrocities. And I'd just be interested in seeing what your, any thoughts you might have on that.
I didn't hear the last.
Just, any thoughts you might have on, seemingly the disjunction between a lot of the breaking news that we see pertaining to the U.S. military, involving wartime atrocities, rape of female service members and things of that nature. But then you also see a particular type of book, magazine articles that seem to idealize, American servicemen too. And I guess the question I have for you is, who is the American military? When you see these two kinds of two approaches to covering the military and writing about it.
That's one of those questions. I really have to see some of that work at first hand. I have to hang out for a while at a barracks or try to go on maneuvers, which in my age is not a sensible idea. I can't. I believe what I read in the papers. But I tend to believe both the good and the bad. And as far as the correspondence is concerned, I think that's as good as it ever was. As we were saying before, in extremely dangerous situations, much more dangerous than Vietnam, say. So. I can't be of much help, I guess, because I don't know the current military situation at all at first hand.
And also, of course, another problem is that the news organizations don't have the wherewithal they used to have, so that they're covering a narrow, the Post, for example, doesn't have any domestic bureaus anymore.
Really?
Nothing
in Chicago, nothing in...
If a story happened somewhere else, I think they got somebody in New York, But if the, if a story happens in Chicago, they send somebody.
Yeah, there. Right. Yeah.
So, yeah.
Mr. Just, I began reading you with Echo House in my early 20s, and I've continued reading you over that time. I think that I see through those novels since that time, at least I feel increasingly kind of the weight of the passage of time as a theme running through much of your work.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if that, is that consistent with what I would find in your early work, or is that just because I'm getting older?
Yeah, I mean, it's, the trouble with writing these things is, you know, every time you sit down to write, you know, you're 2 years older than the last book, and in my case, it's usually 2 years, and so the years accumulate, and the weight of the past accumulates, and then if you're not lucky, what you find yourself is just writing about the past period, which can be productive. I mean, people have done it, but you don't want to sort of give it all up that quickly, it seems to me. Did I answer that question at all? Was that helpful? I'm trying to be helpful.
It was helpful. I'm curious if I would find that same weight of the passage of time in your early work.
You wouldn't.
Okay.
For sure.
Ward, thank you very much.
My pleasure.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.